Dad's Hour on Radio City Talk with Mick Coyle.
Radio City Talk.
My name's Mick Coyle. Welcome to Dad's Hour for another week as we talk parenting matters. We've got Iain, Christie in the studio. Hello.
Afternoon, Mick.
And we've got... Iain. Iain Christie's what? In the studio.
What more do you possibly need?
How are you on this fine, fine Friday? Suspiciously fine Friday.
I know, I'm a bit annoyed because I switched from summer uniform to winter uniform at work. Because summer uniform is jeans and a shirt with rolled up sleeves. And winter uniform is jeans and a jumper. But I've committed to winter uniform. And the last 2 days, I've been uncomfortably warm.
You know when people talk about that, I've had to break out the winter wardrobe. Mm. Like, my winter wardrobe is the T-shirt that I was wearing all summer. Under a jumper.
But with a jumper over it, yeah.
But and I haven't moved those. Those jumpers have been exactly where they were all summer.
2 years ago, I went to a shop in Liverpool City Centre and I purchased 5 jumpers. And I went back into the office and I said, I have bought 5 jumpers. That's me done for 5 years. And everybody laughed and I don't know what they were laughing at. I am, like, it's fine. You wear them Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday. Give them a wash every couple of weeks. You know, because jumpers don't need washing.
Now
much,
I'm with you on this one.
You know,
so preaching to the converted here.
Give them a wash when they start to smell.
Just before they start to smell.
All right, just before they start to smell. You sound like my wife. But give them a good wash, and that's it. And then once you reach sort of March-ish, you know, April, depending on the weather, then they go into the wardrobe, and then they reappear in late September. What more do you need?
So Christmas jumpers.
Novelty Christmas jumpers.
So I have one novelty Christmas jumper.
Yeah.
And we had a thing, and then we went, oh, Mick, I didn't think you'd own a novelty Christmas jumper because you're not what, you know.
You're not normally known for being fun.
But I was like, nah, the joke's on you. And every single day we do this novelty Christmas jumper thing, every year.
Yeah.
I am wearing the same jumper. I wear it once. I wear it for the day.
Yeah.
I give my money to Cash for Kids. Mm-hmm. And I post for the photo. And then it goes home. It gets washed.
Yep.
I think it gets washed and it goes back in the cupboard and it sits there. But because it's like a novelty Christmas jumper, it takes up a lot of room.
Yeah.
And even them vacuum bags for it.
I'm with you on this as well because I got a really, really, really nice novelty Christmas jumper about 7-8 years ago. And my wife bought it for me and she didn't say how much she paid for it, which is always a concern. She said, I've got this. And I put it on and it is one of the nicest garments you'll ever wear. It's soft and warm and fluffy and it's not so novelty, it's not got hilarious stuff stuck to it or anything. So it's, I don't think you'd have such a thing as a classy Christmas jumper, but it's definitely the classier end of it.
Could you get away with it on January the 3rd?
Unlikely. It's still, but it needs that to be a Christmas jumper. A Christmas jumper isn't a Christmas jumper if you could get away with it on January the 3rd.
See, I just think I wear it one day a year. It doesn't need replacing.
It doesn't.
It shrunk a little bit the first time I washed it, but yeah. I'm still good.
Each year mine shrinks a little bit, it's funny.
Now, I've got to raise this issue. It's an important issue, but it's that time of the year. We're talking the end of September,
yep.
2018. We're at the end of a period of warm weather,
yeah.
Which has been warm since, well, as long as I can remember. I can't even remember it being cold before. But there comes a point where somebody says in the house, should we put the heating on? Mm. Now, I always think there is like a dad alarm that goes off each year, because there is a moment where you are prepared to put on the heating, normally after the end of September, but there's a moment halfway through September where deep down you know that heating does need to come on sooner.
And also there's the little dummy run that the weather does, and it happened, you're right, about 2 weeks ago, where it went cold for a couple of days. I mean, I'll be honest, I've just got as far as shutting the window in the bedroom, so I'm not quite on putting the heating on yet. But I'm better than I was. When I was younger, I used to be so tight. Like I'd sit there and like my wife would go, it's a bit chilly. And I go, well, put a jumper on. And so she put a jumper on. And then like 2-3 days later, it's getting a bit parky, isn't it? Well, put a blanket around you. So she'd be sat on the sofa with a jumper on and a blanket. And I'm still sat there in shorts and a T-shirt, right? Because I'm fortunate, I was blessed with kind parents who kicked me out in all weathers to play in shorts and a T-shirt, which I'm doing to my kids. And it's a down payment on heating bills when they're older, because I do not feel the cold. So I am fine. Thank you very much.
I have that same thing. I think the moment where she wants to get the blanket out is the moment that I notice there is a bit of a chill.
That's the bit I do feel a little bit guilty as well. Because we've got the heat in, you know, and that kicks in. But as we get into December, we've got a fire as well. Like, and sometimes the fire goes on when the heating's on. And I'll allow the fire, right? We sound like a 1930s fire. But I'll permit the fire as long as all doors are closed within the room that the fire is in.
So this is the thing that I'm in, right? So when we got our new boiler, with an 8-year guarantee, by the way.
Ooh.
Mm. It came with one of those, you know, you can have it anywhere in the house, press the button. And the thing that gets me is that kids go to bed, my wife and I are watching TV in one room.
Yeah.
And then the heating's got to come on to heat, like, the back end of the kitchen. No one's going to do any... And unless you go and turn off all the thermostats individually, you're warming the whole house just for the sake of two people sitting on the couch watching Graham Norton.
If you're in the kitchen cooking, you've probably got the oven on.
Yeah.
Or at least a kettle. You know, it's just there's some heat being given off. You don't need heating in the kitchen.
I have done that thing where you cook something in the oven and then you leave the oven door open thinking, well, that residual heat will warm this room for a little bit of time.
I've also got our radiator in the kitchen is underneath some cupboards, and in front of that is a low table, and the low table is where rubbish goes, you know, piles of junk. And in winter, I make a special effort to clear that table because all we're doing is heating the junk.
We're
heating piles of paper. Why are we heating piles of paper? To clear it out. If we're gonna have the heating on, make it heat the room.
We got
welcome to Tightwad Hour.
we got in our house because we had kept having shoes. There's shoes everywhere in this hall. So we got a shoe rack, but we got it, and we didn't just get a shoe rack where you can see all the shoes. We got a shoe rack where you could fold it all the way,
like
a cupboard, thinking that'll be nice and neat. No, all we did is we created another platform on which you can put stuff. So currently, if we went to my house right now, my shoe rack would have shoes in the shoe rack, but also shoes around the shoe rack.
And on the shoe rack?
On the shoe rack, I think you'd be looking at...
sunglasses.
A pair of sunglasses. My daughter's sunglasses case, which I know for a fact don't have any sunglasses in because she lost them.
And you'll never use.
It will contain at least three of those charity bags
that
come around with charities you've never, ever heard of, but want your clothes, but not your bric-a-brac. Under no circumstances.
Have you got one of those liquid shoe polish bottles? They tend to gather there.
That's actually in. What is on there? One of those rollers, a lint roller. Lint roller on top of
there. It's like the worst episode of the Generation Game.
And then there's normally something which we've put there because it's at the bottom of the stairs. Something which we are supposed to either take upstairs.
Oh, I see.
Bit of bathroom cleaner. Or it'll be something we've had upstairs, which we have supposed to take downstairs to the recycling.
There's nowhere for it to live.
Such as an empty bottle, a bathroom cleaner. Or you might sometimes get up to two empty toilet rolls on there.
It's good. Well, that's where these things have to live. That's where these things have. Because we've got our keys above that. And so... We have to clear it out when you can't hang your key on the peg anymore. Yeah. You know, there's a 6-inch gap of grace where you can put things on, and then once you clear that 6 inches. But I don't think there is a clear surface in our entire house. I think it's reasonable to say that. I think that there's a clear surface in the kitchen where I cook. But apart from that, I can't think of a space which hasn't got rubbish all over it.
Well, you know when they go on like a Homes Under the Hammer and they do like, oh, now here's what the place looks like, and they've all done a nice job there, and they go, this person, how much do you reckon you can get? And then the person tells you can get £400 a month for this one, and they come on and go, well, we've actually already got residents in and they're paying £450 a month, and they feel really smug. But have a look around. Lying. Nothing on the surfaces. Nothing on the surfaces at all. There's nobody living there as well. Everything's too neat.
Do you know what I need? I need a burglar to break in, but a burglar with no discernible taste, with like really low standards. So he comes in and he's just got several big bags and he just steals everything off the surfaces. And do you know what? I think, you know, if you were burgled and you came home and all your surfaces were clean and the police came around and said, what did they take? I don't know.
The lint roller.
Months later, you'd be going, hang on, where's the other shoe? Like, that's it.
I think that there's sometimes upwards of 5 pence, but in copper coins.
And €2.
€2. Hair clips, that's the other one as well, might find their way onto there as well.
One day, I think that archaeologists, are going to be on the site of our house, and they'll be wandering around, wondering why there are so many bubbles buried in the wreckage of this house. Hair bubbles, just thousands and thousands of hair bubbles.
But as soon as you try and make a place for anything, it becomes overflowing with that item. Yeah. So we got one of those little plastic baskets. And I said, you know what? We'll put that next to the sofa so that when we sit down, when you get home from work and you got a credit card bill, right, I need to act upon that, put it into this thing, which I'll then use as like an in-tray. And then you get something about your home insurance renewal.
Yeah.
And then you get something about your home insurance renewal, contains all your new documents, but actually you go to someone else anyway. So then you get their version of those documents. Yep. But you keep all the documents. Why would you throw the other set of documents that you didn't actually sign up for?
That's the only thing I need this burglar to do. It needs to go through and throw away bank statements from 1994 that I still have in a cupboard, you know.
Even the thing where you go, let's have a bag. This one bag will hold all the other bags. And then suddenly this one bag is bursting at the scene.
Do you know what I saw on the online? You know, there's one friend that shares literally everything on Facebook, you know, every post that they come across. And it was one of these life hacks, right? And the idea was that you have baskets on the bottom four steps, one for each of you, you know, mum, dad, two kids. And anything that is found downstairs goes into these baskets. And then, theoretically, as you walk up the stairs, you go, oh, yeah, I was meant to put that jumper away. I will take it upstairs. Or, oh, yeah, there's the toys that were left lying around. Let's go and take those upstairs. But realistically, what will happen is you will end up with four overflowing baskets on the bottom four. It's as Lynn Folds would say, it is a potential death trap.
I think that's the other thing, yeah, that sometimes, because I do that, I go, well, I'll tell you what, I'll put that at the bottom of the stairs because then I'll remember to take it up. And when I'm coming back down the stairs, having not taken it up and fall over it, I then think, who's left that there?
Do you know what I threw away off the bottom of our stairs about a month and a half ago?
Lint roller.
No. a Christmas gift bag with a bottle of shampoo in that my wife had collected from somewhere. And you do think that, you know, that is definitely time stamped, that a Christmas gift bag.
Iain Christie's with us in the studio. It's Dad's Hour. I'm going to talk about homework. Rob Delaney had put something on social media, which kind of made me smile because he's quite a funny guy, about doing homework. He's got a seven-year-old. He was talking about homework. He was basically saying, how can I make this stop, or what group can I join to try and make this stop, that kids should be allowed to sort of go out and about and enjoy themselves and play and be children. Gary Lineker has joined in the conversation. He says... seems an awful lot of parents agree on the pointlessness and stressful nature of homework. Kids should be allowed to play and enjoy home life with their parents without the divisiveness as work. They have plenty of time to do at school. Homework is a waste of time, brings stress to the home, stress to the child, stress to the parents, stress to the parent-child relationship. Reading every night should suffice. Disagreeing with that one is Piers Morgan, but nobody cares what he thinks. What do you think?
Well, that's tricky, because I was in favour of homework, and suddenly said disagreeing with that was Piers Morgan. I think homework's important. I think too much homework is a problem. We're quite lucky. The school that my two go to are brilliant. Love them to bits. They each get their 7 and just turned 10. Little pause while I remembered how old my kids were. And they each get a piece of homework each weekend. So they get to they're meant to do reading from their school books each night or every couple of nights. There's a spelling test on a Friday that they need to revise for, but a piece of homework. It'll be maths or English or history or something. It'll take about half an hour. So on a Sunday afternoon, sit down with the two of them. I can do both sets of homework with them. If I'm lucky, they'll do it simultaneously. If I'm not, it's an hour out of my day. Fine. A friend of ours has just moved schools. Their little ones just moved schools. And he's the same age as little one. He's only 7 going on 8. And they're getting homework, like, I think it's 4 times a week. Now, that's too much. Because once you factor in, you know, brownies on a Monday and, you know, football on a Tuesday and, you know, choir on a Friday, swimming on a Thursday, there's no... You have to sacrifice some of the extracurricular stuff in order to do the homework. But I don't know. See, but I get, when I was little, both mum and dad worked. So I used to stay at school doing the homework club, which was basically an extra 2 hours on the end of the school day where you'd sit there and you'd be all in a classroom. You all did your homework. And once you'd all finished your homework, you all went out and played football. Right. So it was just doing another lesson for me. You just sat there and you went, fine, I've done all my homework. Can I go out and play football now? Yes. So when I was a kid, I've got no reference point for this. But the kids, I don't know. It depends on what the homework is. Sometimes they'll hit the roof and it takes ages to get done. But other times, it's a good little test for you as well.
Yeah, well, there's that element, the personal challenge element to it. But I almost liken it to, you know, when businesses insist that you, you know, are always on your email, that you're always contactable away from the office, always got to be at the end of the phone. Because they don't really know what you do or what you're capable of or really what your sort of level is at. So they basically just go, well, as long as they're always doing something, that should be all right. Yeah. And I always think that that's the case with homework, that this idea, well, some more maths, do they understand that? I don't really know. Would a bit more maths help? Maybe so. Do I need to do that match with them? No, they can do it. Oh, I do think it's a little bit of a cop-out that you're in lessons and you're in from 9 o'clock until 12 o'clock. That's 3 hours in the morning. Then it's probably, give or take, 2 hours in there. That's 5 hours of learning. Now, you would look at a child who is, let's say, 7. That's the age Rob Delaney hung. 5 hours of learning in a day. I think that is enough learning. If that then involves 20 minutes reading before
bed, I think you're underestimating your child here.
No, but I just think the other elements where you suddenly go, well, maybe they want to do something else. Maybe they have got clubs. Now, the other thing is that it's kind of like an all or nothing thing. Like, there's homework, you've got to do it. But if you went in the next day and went, they didn't do their homework last night because they came out, they had the football team practice, and then they went to Brownies after the thing, there wasn't enough time. Would the school go, that's absolutely fine? Or would the school go, well, actually, Mr. Christie, we're actually quite concerned that they've missed the deadline now?
I think it depends, because, again, homework is preparation for the next lesson. That's what I was taught when I was at school. So if you don't do your homework...
And you lapped it up.
Oh, I loved it. I love a bit of homework, right? But if you haven't done your preparation, if you haven't done your prep, then you're behind. So when the teacher is saying, okay, now we're going to do fractions, and you haven't looked at fractions, then you're the one with the mitt in the air going, oh, I don't understand. And like, it means the other kids can't get on.
No. You see, what you've done there is you've bought into the homework world.
I believe in homework.
So you don't know something, so I'm going to teach it to you. In your little world there, you've gone, you don't know something, and that's your fault.
I want my kids to be teaching the class.
Like, a teacher would then start to teach something, and in your world, the kid will already know because he's already prepped it. Yeah. No, the teacher's job is to teach the child from blank, from zero. If that then involves them going home and just sort of reminding themselves of that, then that's understandable. It shouldn't be, right, tomorrow we're learning about French. Your homework is to learn French.
We had, I remember my eldest getting a particularly difficult piece of maths homework, and you fall back on the maths that you learned when you were a kid. So I was saying, okay, well, here's how you do this. And you're thinking back, going, all right, how do we do that? Okay, you divide that by that and multiply that by that and all this. And we're going through it. And it, well, I think it was fractions. It was something to do with fractions. It was a couple of years ago. And at parent-teacher day, which was about a month later, I said, oh, well, the homework's okay, but she's been struggling a little bit with fractions. And the teacher said, oh, yeah, we haven't done those in class yet. And I said, well, how's she meant to do this? And she said, well, you know, the homework is preparation for that. But the concern for that is that I was teaching her one way to do it, and the teacher taught in a different way.
So learn how to do something
yep.
away from the structure of a yep. classroom, and then I'm going to teach you basically the same thing, but the way wrong. You should have learned it in the first place.
Yeah. And I think that's
not right.
That creates strong-willed children. with a sense of independence and authority.
It's 1:45. Dad's hour for a Friday. Iain Christie's in the studio as well, the man who loves homework. He loves it. If you've got homework, your kids have got homework, send it to Iain Christie, courtesy of the Royal Court. He'll get it boxed off, packaged up Sunday night. He'll wash your school uniforms as well.
And anything under the age of 10 I can deal with. I suspect once we get past sort of 11, 12, I'm going to start to struggle.
Shout to anybody who's been doing a McMillan coffee morning, by the way. So my wife, she was baking a chocolate cake last night. And she said, I said, what are you going to do? She goes, like a Victoria sponge, but chocolate and covered in chocolate.
Okay.
I was like, that sounds sensational. She says, no, I'm going to a McMillan coffee morning. Mm. So I'm going to take that. I was like, well, do you have to take the whole cake? Yes, you have to take the whole cake. With a proviso that you take a cake, but then also when you're there, you then buy a cake. Yeah. But I feel like my wife has taken like Real Madrid to the coffee morning. And there's a danger I might come back with Watford.
Well, the McMillan coffee morning is an amazing thing. It's brilliant. I've had some McMillan cake today. I'm now not going to give any more money to McMillan because it's finished me off. But no, I think the girls had to do one for school yesterday, and we had to do one for work today. We didn't have to, but there was a competition element, so obviously I'm going to enter. So I ended up doing a batch for Poppy, the little one. Then in the morning, I got up at 6:30 and got the eldest up because she wanted to make hers with me. Great, so we made them yesterday. Then last night I got in and did another two batches for work today. And I caught myself this morning. The girls sort of reached out these, you know, banana muffins and kind of reached out to get one. And I literally sort of tapped her on the back of the hand. I went, no, they are for work, not for you. And I just had this massive flashback from when I was a kid because Mum always used to bake cakes for the church. She'd bake cakes for, you know, leaving dues, everything. You know, I'll bake a cake. Did we ever get cake? Did we Never. We used to get cake if the cake had fallen in the middle.
Yeah, yeah.
Sort of the burnt off cuts. You know, we used to burnt off cuts. So I've promised myself I'm going to make cakes with the girls this weekend so they can eat the cakes. Because otherwise, it's like cake is for other people, not for you.
Well, so this chocolate cake yesterday, which whoever gets is very lucky because it looked absolutely sensational. But he was like, no, you can't eat that chocolate cake now.
Mm.
You can eat a slightly stale cake tomorrow night.
Yeah, and the smell
it's been
as well.
So
you'll be walking and go, oh, because I did these things last night and you go, oh, they smell great, but I cannot touch them.
See, that's why I like a coconut macaroon. I think they smell great. When my wife was, she was doing bath time upstairs. The thing is, you've got two kids, one who does the real bath, real proper bath, and then a little baby who goes in a little baby bath.
Yeah, yeah.
Little baby in the baby bath, in, out. Basically just dip them, and then they're done. And then the great thing then is you then put them in pyjamas and then put them on the bed. They fall asleep.
Brilliant.
While my wife is untangling long hair of a child and things like that. But I went downstairs and she'd half prepped the cake. She put the sponges in. She'd left them out on the side with the icing.
Ooh.
Mixed, and you know that like Tom and Jerry thing, you know, that
she'll where know me
just gets like a smell in the end and just floats into the room. That was me yesterday thinking, this is the perfect crime here, because all I need to do is stick in a finger, get a massive wadge of the chocolate icing,
she'll know,
give it a little stir again, no one would ever know,
she'll know, they know. I got caught at the other end of that because on Wednesday morning I bought a load of stuff to go in these cakes that I was making, and included buttons, chocolate buttons, milk chocolate buttons, and chocolate orange segments. You know, we're going into a couple of the different things making. It was, you got to do it properly. Not official, you know, I got them from a budget German supermarket. So I spent on these things. It had about five packets of buttons and a couple of big bags of the chocolate orange segments.
Jerry's chocolate orange.
Jerry's chocolate orange. All of them for like about 50p each. Brilliant. Rock on. Got home on last night to make the thing with the chocolate orange to see the kids finishing off the second bag of chocolate orange segments. At least one of the white chocolate buttons had gone. So then I had to go to the standard supermarket at the top of the road and pay £2 each for actual chocolate oranges to replace them. And you know, why did you eat? There were two bags of chocolate orange segments in the cupboard. They know I'm making cakes. And it was authorised by my wife. She approved that.
You listen to First World Problems on Radio City Talk. Page 28 of the Daily Mail. Top priority story here. Half of young adults are now predicted to go to university, fulfilling Tony Blair's pledge. Oh, he had a dream, did our tone. Tony Blair, he had a dream. Education, education, education. 49.8% of people are now projected to enter higher education before they are 30. Now, there's one or two things people might talk about when they talk about Tony Blair.
Yes.
His particular suggestion that half of people would go there. I think at the time we all thought that would be, wasn't that great that half of young people would get an incredible opportunity that was previously thought to be only available for those within the sort of the middle to upper middle classes, the higher classes as well. Instead, it's for everybody. Now the dream has been fulfilled. People are starting going, maybe Tony Blair was thinking about this, the idea that the best way to get everybody on board is to saddle them with a load of debt, which they then have to live with. I got my student loan bill through.
Oh, yeah.
I left university in 2003. I only owed £9,900, which is basically less than a year's fees and costs and things like that now. So I thought that'll be all right because 15 years later, I'll be laughing. £4,500 still owed. I'm not quite, or I'm about halfway.
Well, congratulations, Mick, because that means that by the time you retire, you'll have pretty much paid that off.
Well, the thing is that I'm getting to the point where after the age of 60, I don't have to pay it off. But now I'm thinking of just looking for a lower paid job.
Yeah, just work your way. Just keep them at arm's length for a bit. But do you know, it sounds really quaint when you talk about the student loans that we used to have.
Oh, yeah.
You know,
yeah.
The kind of like the £9,000 owed, the £5,000 owed, this sort of thing. Because kids are coming out. I mean, Tony Blair's pledge was to see that, you know, being in a lot of debt is available to all. And they're carrying like 50, 60, 70 grand's worth of debt when they leave. And it's only going to get more expensive.
Well, let me tell you this. The average debt is £50,000, £800. £50,800.
Okay.
So
the average debt.
Average. So that means that some will be a little bit less than that. Some will be more. Some might be a lot less. Some will be a lot more as well. But the problem with that is, right, now, it used to be 18. You get to 18, certainly 21, key to the door. Your life could begin. You could go get a job. You can go and buy a house. You know, you probably met somebody.
500 quid.
You know, it'd be a relatively simple process. Those would be the steps now. But I would say now, if you're 18 years of age, and I'll be advising my daughter to do this, stay in education, absolutely.
Yeah.
But if you can stay in education without having to rack up 50 grand's worth of debt, then you're doing yourself favours, because there are ways to educate yourself without actually having to get a piece of paper at the end of it. But it strikes me as like, it seems now like a good thing. Young people are going to university, learning more. Education is important as well.
And also vocational courses. My kids are going to be doctors, vets, lawyers, plumbers, electricians. I don't care, as long as the job that they're doing, they're going to come out with a job waiting for them, or an apprenticeship waiting for them. Because I did English. Like, can you imagine? Like, my mum and dad must have been going, well, what's he going to do with that? He might end up working in a theatre or something. You know, he might end up talking nonsense on the radio for half an hour. This sort of, they need a commitment. That if I'm spending on their education as well, I'm going to make sure they go to every lecture. None of this drinking and swanning about the place. I want 8 hours lectures a day, 5 days a week. I want loads of homework. If I'm paying for this, then those tutors are going to be working, marking books.
The top five careers teenagers aspire to.
Is it being on Big Brother?
Love Island. No. Writers.
Okay.
Actors or TV producers.
Yes.
That was one.
Okay.
Second one, teachers or lecturers.
Okay.
Health professionals.
Good. We need more of them.
Police officers or firefighters.
So there's teenagers who still want to be a fireman. Good.
Or to be nurses or to be midwives. However, of the more than 1 in 10 youngsters who wanted to work in media or theatre, only 1 in 50 were actually employed as such in their late 20s. So you are in many ways a modern day wonder.
I am a 1 in a million shot, to be honest.
But also, you having your job is holding back a young person having their dream.
And that's what makes me warm. It keeps me warm at night. Just the thought of all those interns banging away at the outside, not getting in, and they're going to wait until I die.
Just really wearing a hole in the chair, refusing to move.
Churning out the same old stuff, getting more and more outdated, and all these people with exciting new ideas, they can wait on the outside.
There was one of the, again, that thing emerged on social media this week, was, what would you say to your 16 or 18-year-old self? And it's hard to know, isn't it? Like what you would say in terms of like, oh no, do a different degree. Now there must be some people who are doing stuff they absolutely hate.
Yeah.
But then, like, would you, to get the job that you did you need to go to university? Maybe not.
Not really. I mean,
would you have not gone to university?
No, I couldn't have not gone. Well, no, I could have not gone to university, but the education that I had, all that sort of stuff, everybody went to university. You know what I mean? I would have been one of about 20 kids or 10 kids in my year that didn't go to university. Because that was early. It was just pre-Blair. I was just pre-Blair, but university was that sort of thing that you did. You got your GCSEs, you got your A-levels, you got your degree. I learnt more at university from living away from home. I could have just moved to Bristol and lived there for 3 years, and I would have learnt roughly the same amount as long as I read a few books while I was there. Because I don't think my writing improved a bit, but you know what I mean? There wasn't much there. What I'm saying, Mick, is pretty much I was a genius anyway. What more could you possibly want?
I think there's an element of that one, because if I went back to university now, I'd be a very different student. I'd probably read the books.
I'd stay in.
Yeah, well, I wouldn't be going out. I'd actually probably concentrate on my studies.
I wouldn't be busking the essays at like 6 o'clock in the morning when they were due in 4 hours' time.
Yeah, and then trying to find a mate who had a printer.
Yeah, that's the one. That's the one.
A printer with an A drive for your floppy disk. It's bigger than 1.44 meg. Of course it wasn't. Nothing was in that time. That was the biggest possible
file.
Do
you know the other thing? What I would say to my student self is stop whinging. You know, when they went, oh, I've got a 2,000-word essay to write. And you go, oh, no, 2,000 words. Like, that's the sort of stuff you knock out in, you know, half an hour at work.
You know what I'd say? I'd say, yes, I know that toaster says somebody else's name in it, but what are they going to do? That's what I'd say today. Yes, I know you've got a flatmate there who's written his name on his toaster. Nick it for a bit.
Yeah.
See what he says.
Yeah.
Just see what happens.
What could possibly go wrong?
And then he'll learn not to put his name on everything. Rob.
Just kidding.
Rob R.
I'm glad you're getting that out of your system, Mick. That's been burning away.
I remember that first day thinking, I need some toast, but can I use the toaster? It says somebody else's name on it. I'll try and use the grill. Oh, I can't.
See, that sets you up for the whole term, doesn't it? It's, yeah.
Rob R.
Rob R.
Wherever
curse you
are.
Rob R.
Iain Christie, thank you for your time. What's going on at the Royal Court?
We've got a big 80th birthday celebration going on Sunday. The building is 80 years old, so we're going to have bits of all the shows that we've done, a little bit of comedy, a little bit of music. It's going to be a right old laugh, really. So that's going on this Sunday. We've got a massive musical called Maggie May kicking off in a couple of weeks' time, with a great cast, loads of good music. Cheryl Ferguson, who's best known as Heather off of EastEnders, is in it, amongst others, so it should be a really good one.
Dad's Hour, available as a podcast as well. Previous editions also available, and you'll be able to download that at the end of the show. You can already download the previous editions if you want. Thanks for checking us out on Radio City Talk.